at six factors of production: capital, labor, and land. So these are the classical factors. Now, when you're talking about capital, you're actually not exactly talking about money, but you know, the machinery, plant, equipment that leads to productivity or production of goods and services. You could say that money is an enabler. Labor is when we are talking about, you know, so these are the classical at one point of time in the industrial revolution happened. Now you need technology to use capital, labor, and land. Now this is another factor that, which we, I have already covered total factor productivity, and it's good if you refer to macroeconomic variables. The other, which I read a paper from the Fed and they have labeled entrepreneurship, which is they label as, you know, the factors which makes use of capital, labor, and land, because an entrepreneur uses these factors and of course technology to come out with the value add, or you can say products and services. Most interesting part is data. Now data is something which China made it as a factor of production. Now we look at why data is a very significant factor. This is one of the comments which are mentioned in National Information Center. It's very good if you read it. This is also from the same paper, and I'll be listing, I have mentioned the link to this particular research paper which I've used. Digital era, data is as crucial as like maybe oil when was there in the industrial economy era. When you talk about data, why data is very important? So looking at data as a factor of production, and we are talking why data is important. So could data be used? One is distributed computing, high performance computing. These are some of the factors. You can say intelligent computing, graph computing. Now data is become so important, and we look at why. When we say why data should be a factor of production, refer to the same report. It came out very interesting analysis derived from that paper. This is not directly mentioned, that data affects both demand and supply equilibrium. What's very interesting is data leads to increase in total factor productivity. Now we have an analysis. According to the analysis, they show that 40% of the labor productivity growth in the US in the last decade is due to data. And there are certain things involved. Now, when we talk about data, it's got an externality, which shows that it's got a positive and also negative externality. Looking at externality, I suggest you refer to the module which I have come out with. And these are some of the things which are very important. It's got a diminishing marginal cost. When we have looked at here, and we'll come to know when you're talking about diminishing marginal cost, what you mean. It's got increasingly returns to scale. Looking at data, what is it doing? It helps you in economic growth, and it helps you in distribution. I suggest that it's a good read. You could know a bit about data. Look at the data as a factor of production. By 2025, according to IDC, China will have the amount of data which is created, collected, and copied would be 27.80. Whereas when you look at the US, it will be 17.50. So this is a very interesting analysis, how much data it is going in. You can understand how much data would become important for so many countries. If you are looking at data, there are some world-class biological data centers which the report mentions. One is the National Center for Biotechnology Information. The other is European Institute of Bioinformatics and Japan DNA Database. Data could be used in different spheres of industry. Just make sure. And now with the pandemic, what we have also realized is that biological data centers would become very important. Just to give you a perspective of why data is so important and why data has become a factor of one of the critical factor of production, especially in the digitalized economy. This is a new thing which I am proposing, which the Middle Road is proposing. The Middle Road's recommendation of a new factor of production is equitable quality education. We have looked at before that the education, we have talked about externalities. Now education has got a huge positive externality. If you have seen the modules, you have known that the positive externalities are heavily subsidized. You have a fair bit of an idea of why, you know, when I'm talking about equitable education, I'm sorry. It leads to an increase in productivity and economic growth. If you're in the labor market, you know, there's been research has been done that it will lead to a higher amount of income, if you look. And, you know, it also leads to well-being. You could look at it if you are by far more educated, you have much more knowledge, you're much more aware of, you know, the good and bad. You could refer to a lot of research reports. So it does help. Now, we're not going to, if there is a definite research being done on that or not. It has a positive impact on demand and supply within an economy. You have a positive demand and supply within an economy. When you're looking at equitable quality education, more and more people would like to, you know, if it's highly subsidized or maybe even free at times, promote higher education, not K-12. If you have equitable quality education, then there is less social inequalities within the system. This is a possibility. You need to, more and more people would come and study, and there'll be a further supply within an ecosystem. So supply in the labor market would increase when I'm talking about, and this supply would lead to more demand, and more supply would lead to a new equilibrium between demand and supply. That's a view which are very closely looked at. They have an increasing marginal return. Now, where did I get this from? I did refer to one of the reports. Now, increasing returns to education theory and evidence. There's a bit of research was done, you know, which they have looked at working hours, wages, and years of schooling. And they did find empirical support. So what you have seen is like they've sort of seen the wage effect, and they've seen increasing returns to education at labor participation margin and elasticity of labor supply with respect to wages. And it's specifically seen among women. Now, this is good. And there's also been a huge increase in home productivity. And when you're looking at home productivity, it's something which we never discount for, because that could lead to also not only very lot of positive externalities. I'm not sure if there's been a research done how much home productivity could has increased because of education in terms of both social and economic of the things which could tell you. Now, these are some of the references. Now, there's another book going to be coming in. So these are two academic books. Now, these are the two reports which I talked about, which you could refer. These are interesting reads, both of them. You can download. I've given you the links. And the third report, which I've talked about here, which is increasing returns to education. There are a lot of other reports which you can see. OECD has a very interesting report. I've not, you know, fully read that, but that's something you can refer. Another book will be coming in, Intermediate Microeconomics by Varian. He referred. And you could also look at it.